All right, it's my pleasure right now to bring on a young lady who certainly is in the WAFB Intern Hall of Fame, without a doubt. I mean, she was mentored by the best, and I mean Steve Schneider, not me. But anyway, Chrissy Freud covers Mississippi State for Saturday Down South. She runs the Mississippi State Twitter account that's on Sports Illustrated. Also covers Tulane for Crescent City Sports. Chrissy, thanks for being on with us.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Did you draw up those plays behind you?
I did. So these are actually, these are air raid plays. So the one over here in the top, I want to say maybe it's your top left corner. Well, the only one in the top that you can see, is Ace 92, but I doubled up the mesh concept. Me and Mike Leach actually talked about this a good bit, and we talked about how it could work. But it's Ace 92, the play in the air raid offense, except the mesh is run twice over. And it kind of looks a little bit more like a trick play, but you've got to have a really good offensive line and some really fast receivers. So I'm waiting for somebody to run it and send me a video of it, but we do think that it could work.
Well, everyone, a lot of coaches are paranoid and stuff about plays, and you can't watch practice and this and that. I'm sure somebody in a chat room somewhere is going to be looking at that play and, you know, trying to see if they're going to run it against LSU this week.
Yeah, I mean, I would like to see it. I mean, Ace 92 will probably come out. That's one that we see almost every single time. I mean, this scheme is founded upon really, in a lot of cases, running five or six plays that you stick with and just go over and over and over again. Now, this year, Mississippi State is running the ball a little bit more. And one thing that I would like for people to know is that there's this common misperception with air raid that air raid simply means throwing the ball over and over again. Now, that's not true because there's several other passing concepts within other offenses that are not air raid plays. And I mean, when I think about the running plays that we don't have very many and we don't run them very often, but like 27 draws, one, they're in there. I took the course with Hal Mummy and I have them in my book over here somewhere. So
there you go. Yeah. Last year, LSU went to Starkville. I think they had a 28-10 lead in the second half. State scored some touchdowns late. The final was 28-25. Certainly 2020, when Mike Leach made his debut at Mississippi State, they torched LSU in Tiger Stadium, LSU's first game after winning the national title. LSU's game plan last year was to drop eight, only rush three, which allowed Will Rogers to kind of read books back there and have all day, but they kept the football in front of them, made the tackle. I've been hearing from some state fans, like you just said, hey, we're running the football better, and if you drop eight, you know, we may gash you for 5-10 yards of carry.
Yeah, I think we're seeing that. We're also seeing some play action stuff, a little bit of RPO stuff as well. So mixing things up a little bit in the offense, but I do still think this is mostly a true air raid team and it's still sticking to its identity. I don't think that Mike Leach would ever move off of that. But when we look at last year's game between Mississippi State and LSU, it was one of those cases where Mississippi State was only one or two plays away from really winning the game. And it had so many different games where that was the case. And we're still seeing a little bit of inconsistency that's come to light, like against Arizona. But outside of that, this is a team that's, I mean, last year, it was two or three times that they had to stage these huge comebacks. A couple of them made it into the record books. But this year, I don't see quite as much of that. And I think it's only a matter of time before this team is clicking on all cylinders with complete consistency. And I think that it's absolutely a huge SEC contender.
They're off to a 2-0 start. Is State first game was delayed by weather for a long time. They handled Memphis no problem, a team that Memphis had beaten them in the past. And then they go out to Tucson, Arizona, to play a very interesting non-conference game. You don't see that every day, an SEC team making that far of a trip on the road to play somebody from the Pac-12. So they won that game decisively as well. So a lot of talk about should this team be ranked or not. And certainly I feel like if they go to Tiger Stadium and win for the second time in two trips to Death Valley, they should break into the top 25.
Yeah, I think so for sure. I think this is a team that has shown what it needs to be ranked, but that it simply doesn't get enough respect. And I think that looking at this game as a whole, it really is a case of what have we here? And what I mean by that is what is LSU? Has LSU come back and fixed all these issues on both sides of the ball against Southern? It's hard to tell because that's a lesser opponent. And then with Mississippi State, is this team for real once it faces legitimate SEC competition? So this game serves really to me as a perfect measuring stick as to where both of these programs are.
Yeah, I don't want to use the term must win this early in the year for LSU, but certainly if you've got two losses before you get out of the month of September and you've got, you know, trips to Florida and you got Alabama coming in, going to Arkansas, who's really good, it seems like, and going to Texas A&M, even if A&M is struggling. I mean, that could be rough for LSU. On the defensive side of the ball for Mississippi State, tell me about what they have going there, because like you said, I feel like there was nothing really LSU could do against Southern that was going to really tell us anything or move the needle. And so I'm very interested to see how LSU's ground game works this week. I'm interested to see what kind of role John Emery might play in the game coming back. So tell me about the Bulldogs on defense.
Yeah, really dominant. I think that the defense faltered a little bit toward the end of the game against Memphis, but held strong other than that. And then when we look at Arizona, I think they did a really good job. And part of that, I think, had to do with Jaden DeLauer's just shortcomings as a quarterback in general. So I think that was a little bit hard to gauge. But I think that Jet Johnson's definitely a guy you're going to see flying around there. I think Mississippi State has a stacked defensive line. And then some guys to watch in the secondary, like Emmanuel Forbes. I think there's a lot of playmakers there, a lot of NFL talent, a lot of underrated talent like Tyrus Wheat. So for lack of better words, they've got some dogs there. And I think that they're going to cause a lot of disruption. And the LSU's offensive line has absolutely got to come to play, which it really didn't against Florida State, which left Jaden Daniels running for his life. And I make the complaint about Jaden Daniels that he bails from the pocket too fast and that he still has some development to make as a passer, which he has. But at the same time, you've got to consider pass protection. You've got to consider how well that offensive line holds up. And I think that they've improved a little bit. But I mean, this is going to be going up against one of the better defenses in the nation, in my opinion.
Yeah, if you're a quarterback and you're dropping back and there's pressure and you're getting hit a lot, then you're going to start to anticipate, right? Then you get a little antsy and you take off maybe before you should, even when you have protection and whatnot. And so I think that's going to be interesting from Jaden Daniels' perspective, what LSU did, say, from the end of the third quarter against Florida State moving forward. Are they able to build on that, or are we going to see more of what we saw in the first three quarters against Florida State in terms of, you know, the only really offensive play LSU was consistent with was Jaden Daniels scrambling? And, you know, you can't maintain that in the SEC. You know that. Eventually an SEC linebacker may get a hold of you and it may not go well. So.
Yeah, I think so. I think I've gained a little bit more respect for Jaden Daniels. Last year in my personal rankings, Jaden Daniels was in my top 15 at one point. But I kind of raised the question because it seemed like at one point Arizona State was not asking him to score through the air very often and really wasn't asking him to throw the ball a ton in a lot of its games. And then when it's I thought that maybe that was just what they were doing. But then whenever he was asked to do so, he failed to rise to the occasion on just several times. And so I'm curious to see how he continues to develop as a passer. I think that he's taken a step, but that there's still more to be seen there, especially on this level of competition.
LSU, of course, missed the extra point or had it blocked against Florida State to force overtime. They had a 30-yard field goal blocked. Watching Mississippi State last weekend, although they dominated, they missed their first two extra points. And I heard Mike Leach on Monday said he was not committed to a kicker yet. That's right, huh?
Yeah, I mean, Mississippi State has had some issues at place kicker since last year. And so the Bulldogs have kind of had to go back and forth. There was a competition throughout the offseason for that as well. And I think that we've seen both of these guys do some good things, but the inconsistency is still there. So this is a problem that seems to be continuing, but doesn't seem to be quite as bad as last year. So it's something they're going to have to get together, especially in a game that could come down to be close. I think that in this one that Mississippi State beats LSU by 10 points, but there is a chance. And based on the point spread, there's a lot of people that do think it's going to be a close matchup.
All right. Yeah, it's a 2.5-point spread. I think it took a big swing. I think LSU initially opened up as a slight favorite, and then it shifted a lot to State. So we'll see what happens before the kickoff.
LSU opened as a favorite in this game, to be honest with you. So
you're surprised by that?
I am. I look at the talent level of both of these teams, not really even just the talent level, but just the rate of consistency and the way that each team has opened the season in the first two games. And I see I could be proven wrong this weekend, and I know how much the Tiger Stadium, the fans come and show out, and how just hostile of an atmosphere that is. But I think that Mississippi State's playing far better football than LSU is right now.
You've gotten to know Mike Leach pretty well, right?
Yes, I have. As a matter of fact, I have so many Mike Leach stories. His cat that he has right now, his name is Maggie. I found her in the parking lot of the training facility, and he told me, it was like, well, if you can catch that cat, I told him about it. He's like, I'll take it home. And I caught the cat, and so that's his cat now. But yeah, but between animal caretaking advice, dog advice. He's got a Labrador Retriever now, sitting in the offensive, the coaching room where they do the film study and all that with him. Yeah, I've gotten to know Mike Leach pretty well in this offense as well, too.
So Mike Leach has a big heart. He took home and rescued a cat from the parking lot. And him being an SEC coach and his salary, that cat's living pretty fat, I would think, right now.
Oh, yeah. No, Hal Mumme, who is his mentor, visited town not too long ago. And I asked him how the cat was doing, and he said that it was living a lavish lifestyle. So
I believe it. A lot of people talk about Mike Leach. You know, he's a national treasure. He, you know, he'll go off on tangents about different subjects. And, you know, we all take this stuff way too seriously. So I think a lot of people enjoy a coach saying, you know, talking about his favorite movie or his favorite band or whatever Mike Leach will talk about. And then some days, like I watched his press conference on Monday. It was just kind of like 10 minutes of grumbling. It wasn't a whole lot in there. So does he kind of give more to people like you, or how would you describe it? Or is he just toying with those people that he's much more smarter than them, so he's just kind of like giving them nothing?
I think it's a combination of all of it. Mike's an interesting guy that's interested in a lot of different things. But I do find that some of the press conferences are a lot more like, let's get down to the football aspect of this. Than some of them he'll go off on tangents like the water bottle, the 75% recycled. He'll just make comments like that from time to time. But when it comes to whenever I ask him questions, he's always been very good. Football wise, I mean, a lot of our conversations outside of taking care of animals, of course, revolve around the X's and O's, just because I've studied this offense for so long and at one point almost went to take a GA position, was really searching for a GA position somewhere within the Air Raid offense. And I mean, him and Hal have been super helpful. And to be honest with you, I've had a pretty big amount of influence just on how I view quarterback play and my knowledge of the game. I mean, I'm happy that I took time to study this offense because it revolutionized the game of football. And I mean, the spread offense is derived from it. And so there's so many concepts from this offense that are existent in every single offense across the nation at all levels of football. So it's been a really good experience.
Well, Hal Mumme certainly back. Let's see. I know you're not supposed to ask someone's age. You're not even 30 years old yet, right?
No, I'm 23.
Oh, okay. 23.
I just turned 23 in July.
Talk about a prodigy, huh, folks? I mean, listen to this young lady speak. But back in 1998, that's 24 years ago, you were not born then. So Hal Mumme in Kentucky came into Tiger Stadium and upset LSU and just, I think, passed for 400 yards or something like that. So that goes back all the way. I mean, that's when Hal Mumme was really making a name for himself nationally. And then later he became the head coach at Southeastern, the Lions, when they brought football back and did an awesome job with them. So certainly, he made his mark in a big way.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, like I said earlier, that everywhere that this offense has gone, it's had a chance and it's turned teams around. I mean, you look at that, like Samford didn't beat Florida, but you think back to that game last year where Samford gave Florida a run for its money. Everybody was tuning in, like, what's happening over here? And I've seen a lot of teams. Nevada ran the Air Raid, had a lot of success, but that was one of the most successful Air Raid teams in the nation. The Wolfpack, whenever Matt Mumme was there, they ran the ball a lot more than some other Air Raid teams do. And he told me that whenever they'd stack the box that they would use their running backs, that they did have some talented running backs over there. So it's just been interesting to see kind of what it does. I mean, there's ways to tweak it. There's several different renditions of the Air Raid. They say that that North Carolina ran it's a little bit different. They use me and Sam Howell talked about that. They use a lot of the passing concepts. They use a lot of the power run game as well. So, but there's certainly, while it's not common for a team to run the pure Air Raid, there is respect for it, which is why the concepts exist in so many different offenses.
When we think about Mike Leach, he always seems to come across as a guy who does less with more. He likes to take a program that's down and out and bring them up to a level. Some people can never imagine him being the head coach at a Clemson and Ohio State and LSU and Alabama or whatever. Do you think that's his sweet spot? Mississippi State, Washington State, Texas Tech, that's kind of where he feels most comfortable?
Yeah, I think there's been a lot of debate about that. Could Mike Leach ever lead like a dynasty team? And my answer to that is Mike Leach doesn't need an Alabama or a Clemson because he can build his own. And I truly do believe that. I mean, as far as recruiting goes, I think that those schools recruit a bit better, but I think that Mississippi State's getting a lot of talent. I think that that's really showing through. And you think about Chris Parson, who I just picked up at quarterback, and then some of the players they have just on both sides of the ball this year as well. This is a team that's not lacking in talent. And I think that everywhere that Mike Leach has gone, he has completely turned that program around with the Air Raid offense. He's had some really good years and brought places like Texas Tech to heights that it had never really seen before. And I think that they missed him after he left. I mean, the people in Lubbock still talk about him all the time. And I think that they really wish that he'd come back. So I think that as long as the recruiting stays as good as it's been and continues to rise, I think that Mike Leach can put the nation on notice of this Mississippi State team as soon as this year, even going up against the toughest schedule in the nation.
I remember when LSU played a season opener in Washington in 2009, and I was just listening to the local sports talk radio, and I came across some guys talking about Washington State, and they were a joke. They were just brutal. They were just like, oh, you know, well, we might win one game this year, you know, whatever. And so for him to go to that school and do what he did, I mean, that was a miracle in itself, really. So to hear the way they were talking about the program then and where he took it. So, yeah, he's done a lot in college football, without a doubt. You being in Starkville, you know, a lot of people make jokes about Starkville. There ain't a whole lot going on there, this and that. You see, you know, you're a young, popular girl. You seem to be happy in Starkville, right?
Yeah, I mean, I am, but I will say I'm happy that Starkville has started building more things, because I remember the first time I came out here, I was like, oh, I need to go get something from Target. And of course, coming over from Baton Rouge, there's a few Targets in the vicinity. And so I plugged it into my phone and I thought that it was an error when it said that it was like over an hour away. So it's a town that doesn't have a lot to do there. You learn to love certain things about it. I mean, I personally like getting out and traveling just because I get bored here from time to time. But I mean, I came here when the opportunity was presented to cover Mississippi State, just because of how I had started a formal relationship with Mike Leach and then how much I'd studied this offense. And really, everyone knows that I like quarterbacks who are pocket passers, those kind of guys, a lot. And those, they exist a lot within the Air Raid offense. And so I kind of came to adopt, I guess, a love for the Air Raid offense, you could say. And I believe that it's the right way to do things. And so I really enjoyed getting out and watching and wanted to learn it more. And so it's been a good experience being out here, even though there's not a ton of stuff to do.
Well, and that just kind of ties into what you were talking about too, in the new age of NIL and recruiting and whatnot, you know, can he get the quality of athletes to take the next step at Mississippi State when you've got Alabama and LSU? I would say Texas A&M, but State might beat them this year. Might beat LSU this weekend. Who knows? So,
yeah, and I think that how Mississippi State performs this weekend against LSU and how Mississippi State finishes out this season, I think that they're already doing a good job. The Bulldogs are on the recruiting trail, but I think that that's going to take even a bigger step after this season.
All right. Well, we're very proud of your efforts and your national television appearances. You've been on Feinbaum twice.
Four or five times.
I'm sorry. All right. Way undersold you there. So the first time you go on something like that, because he don't ask me to be on it, to be honest with you, but or any of us. But when the first time you go on, and I will compliment him on that. I think he's done a very good job of getting younger people on his show. He'll bring people on from the college newspapers around the SEC and whatnot. But the first time you go on, do you just try not to think too much of how many people are what? Like, there could be millions of people watching this. You just, you know, like you're talking to one of your cats, maybe something like that.
Yeah, I mean, the first time I honestly had to psych myself out and pretend like I was just talking to some random person on the phone, just because, I mean, I had watched it so often. I mean, I remember working as a waitress in Baton Rouge, and it would be on the TV, and then you were the one who's on it, and you're not waiting tables anymore. So it's a pretty cool experience. But I'd say after about the third time of doing it, it becomes like nothing. And then whenever I was at SEC Media Days and I did it in person, live on the set, that was kind of a surreal experience to be out there, just because, I mean, it's been a long time since I've been on like a traditional TV set, especially on a stage like SEC Media Days. But at the same time, there's kind of the feeling of like you're just sitting at a table talking to someone. It's kind of weird whenever you get a bunch of followers on Twitter and people start messaging you and then you realize it was actually on national TV, just because you're not the one watching it. You're just sitting at a table talking to someone.
Yeah. Well, I admire you and the job you've done. And certainly in today's age, too, you know, I've been someone who's had success with the social media stuff and Twitter, but I'm finding it's harder and harder really to interact there. You know, I just feel like I'm just sharing more. Here's a story. I'm sharing it and sharing information. I could tweet, it's a beautiful day outside, isn't it great? And someone's going to argue with me. You know, becoming more and more toxic.
Oh yeah. No, Twitter is very much a cesspool. I mean, I enjoy having conversations on Twitter, but I've reached 14,100 followers, somewhere around there. And I feel like after you break like 8,000 is when you start getting like a lot of hate followers, a lot of people who want to say ugly things. And yeah, no, I agree with you that you can't say anything without somebody getting mad or somebody making some comparison to something that you said, putting words in your mouth and twisting it around into something that it is not even remotely, just to have an argument and just to say something to someone who has a platform. So yeah. I mean, I use Twitter as I will. I've gotten to a point where I really truly don't care, to be honest with you. but I would say that I could probably have one of those mean tweet shows where I read the mean tweets, because I'm sure I've gotten over 1,000 within just the past 6 months. So,
well, I mean, someone could grab one quote out of our discussion here and put it in a headline, and it would totally be misleading of what we talked about. I think you can do that with any conversation, really. You know, grab people's attention, get them all worked up. They don't even read the article. They just start You know, so yeah, I find that's the case. And but there's an old saying, if people aren't talking about you, you're not doing anything. So only, you know, even the ones who I consider the best in the business, even, you know, Kirk Herbstreit and Reese Davis and whoever the case may be, the guys at the top, the second they tweet something, someone's jumping in to try to disagree so they can gain more followers or whatever. So sorry to bring the conversation in the ditch, but I just real quick there. So will you be in Tiger Stadium?
I unfortunately will not be making the trip this time around. I had something come up that required me to stay here, but I'm sure that it's going to be fun for everyone that is there. It's one of the best atmospheres in college football, and I've really enjoyed, I can't remember how long I was there. I want to say 4 years. Yeah, I was in Baton Rouge for 4 years. So
it's, I'm a little take when you said you were 23. I'm like, was she interning when she was like 18? I mean,
Yeah, I was.
Okay. Well, there you go. Well, good stuff. Well, Chrissy, thanks a lot. Thanks for being with us today. And we look forward to following you and everything, all your work in the 2022 season and beyond.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Good to talk to you again, Jacques.
You too.